Good morning. Welcome to Midway United Methodist Church. My name is Amanda Lane. I'm one of the pastors here. It's my pleasure to welcome you to worship, whether you are here in person or worshiping with us online this morning. We want to ask that everybody would register your attendance. You can do that with a tear out in your bulletin or by going to the What's Happening page. Just scan the QR code that's on the inside of your bulletin. Let us know that you're here. Update us with any prayer concerns you might have. If this is your first time worshiping with us this morning, we want to extend a special welcome to you. We want to invite you to grab one of those blue cards in the pew in front of you. Register your attendance there and let us know that you are here. We always like to get some information so that we can follow up and greet you. I want to remind you of many different opportunities. As the school year is beginning, we have lots going on. So bear with me, and if you miss anything, it's in here. Take this home, or you can go to our What's Happening page, and that will tell you everything you need to know and more. Next week at 11 o'clock, we are doing a blessing of the backpacks. We want to invite all of our teachers, administrators, school bus drivers, kids, anybody who works for the school system to come and bring their backpack or briefcase so that we might bless them for the next school year. It's also Promotion Sunday, so if you are going into sixth grade, this will be the Sunday that you get to move up and join Mr. Nate and our youth group. Music for Missions is going to be on Saturday, September the 7th. Ticket sales will begin next week. And it's $25, and that includes dinner at 5:30 and a show at 7 p.m. We also want to encourage you, if you are talented in the entertainment way, we want to encourage you to sign up to participate. Alex signed up. You can talk to Melissa or Kirk if you have any questions about that, but we do need a couple more acts to help us make this a great evening. Additionally, you see these supplies here on the altar. We are collecting supplies for our preschool. You'll find on the back of your bulletin a QR code next to supply drive. Our preschool does so much to reach out to the community and to bring in people that are not churched. And we want to say thank you to the teachers, first of all, who are ambassadors for that. But we also want to just shower them with a little bit of love. So if you would scan that QR code, it will take you to the Amazon wish list for the preschool. And you can purchase stuff there and it will come directly to the church. And finally, but probably one of the most important things that we do here is Family Promise. We will be hosting families the week of August the 11th. There are many opportunities for you to be involved in this ministry, from helping to set up, to helping to tear down, to hosting a meal, to talking with families, to staying overnight. There's many, many opportunities for you to get involved on many different levels. You can go to the What's Happening page to sign up. There's a sign-up genius there. If you have any questions, you can talk to Al or Violet Lycom. It's exciting this time of year, but it's also an opportunity now for us to focus our hearts and to focus our minds on the worship of God. As you are able, would you stand and join us for our call to worship, which is printed in your bulletin. We are branches rooted in the vine of Christ. We come because we seek to abide in Christ. The branches that remain in the vine bear much fruit. We come because we long to be spiritually vibrant, alive, fruitful. If we abide in Christ, then Christ will abide in us. We come because we strive to be faithful disciples. We gather for worship now to the glory of the one God, Creator, Redeemer, Sustainer. May we grow eagerly as God tends us lovingly. Let us pray. God of love, plant us in the soil of your grace. Nurture us with the strength of Christ, the vine of everlasting life. Enlighten us with the wisdom of your Spirit, which flows through us today and every day. Abide in us, that we may abide in you and live in your love. In your holy name, we pray. Amen.
Amen. And if you would turn to number 89 in your hymnal as we open today with Joyful, Joyful, We Adore Thee.
Joyful, joyful, we adore thee, God of glory, Lord of love. Hearts unfold like flowers before thee, opening to the sun above. Melt the clouds of sin and sadness, drive the dark of doubt away. And angels sing around thee, center of unbroken praise. Field and forest, vale and mountain, flowery meadow, flashing sea, chanting bird and flowing fountain, call us to rejoice in thee. Thou art giving, spring of the joy of living, ocean depth of happy rest. Thou our Father, Christ our brother, all who live in love are thine. Teach us how to love each other, lift us to the joy divine. Mortals, join the chorus which the morning stars began. Love divine is reigning o'er us, binding all within its span. Ever singing, march we onward, victors in the midst of strife. Joyful music leads us onward in the triumph song of life.
Would you remain standing and join me as we affirm our faith using the historic Apostles' Creed? I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
be to the Father and to the Son and to the Holy Ghost, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be.
As we come together now and offer ourselves to God, we want to say thank you so much for your generosity over VBS and AMP. We have one more opportunity for you to help before the school year gets kicked off. We would love to help our neighbors, Midway Elementary. As you know, they've moved into a new school this year, and our AMP team helped to assemble and put up a shade on their playground. But the teachers need our help this time. They need some help Monday through Wednesday with some classroom organization and some clerical work. A sign-up genius was posted in Midway Family last night. If you're in that Facebook group, you saw it. It was also sent out through email. If you have any questions, please contact Beth Garvin. Thank you so much for your willingness to serve and to love our neighbors. As our ushers come forward, let's lift up our hearts and minds in prayer to God. God, we thank you so much for the gifts and these givers. Lord, be with them, be with us. Use these gifts to impact our community and the world. In your name we pray, amen. My portion, my cause.
this morning as we continue on in our time of worship and we come to a time of pastoral prayer. I've got a prayer this morning that comes from the Lectio 365 app. It's one of those prayers that as I read through it this morning, I thought this would be a beautiful way, I believe, for us this morning to kind of enter into this time of prayer. And what I will do is, rather than kind of reading all the way through it, I want to read each section, because it does. It focuses on God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. And so what I want to go ahead and do is I'm going to read each section, and then I want to afford us an opportunity to just kind of enter into a moment of silent prayer, an opportunity for you in that moment to offer up whatever it is you want to offer up to God. So you join me this morning as we go now before God in prayer. Thank you, Father. Thank you for loving me with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. Inspire me this week to love you more with all of mine. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you for your faithful and sacrificial friendship. Help me this week to be a faithful and sacrificial friend like you. Holy Spirit, thank you for listening to my many thoughts, my words, and dreams. Still my soul this week to listen much more carefully to yours. Father, for the joy of being able to gather together and to come to you in a time like this, an intimate time of prayer as we offer up ourselves to you this day as an act of worship. Father, thank you that you hear our prayers and that you respond to our prayers. Father, continue to offer us wisdom and guidance as your church to live out what it means to be faithful followers and disciples of your Son, Jesus Christ. And Lord, will you hear us now as we offer up that same prayer that Jesus taught his disciples to pray? Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Well, this morning we are going to be closing out this series that we have been in for the past 7 weeks entitled A Living Faith. And today we're going to look at what it means to be disciples and followers of Jesus Christ, but also how a living faith disciples others. And so I'm going to be looking a little bit later at John chapter 15. It's probably a very familiar passage for you, but we'll be looking specifically at verses 1 through 8. This morning, and I'll just say this, that Jesus was a master storyteller. Jesus was able to contextualize stories, or what we know the Bible to tell us is parables, those things that helped him communicate, these stories that helped him communicate his message. And these parables and stories help connect what we know today to be these theological truths about God and about the kingdom of God, and also how we as a people of God are called to live out our lives as followers and disciples of Jesus Christ. And so today our focus is going to be on what it means for us to remain or abide in Christ and what that looks like in terms of an active and living faith. So I want to read to you this morning from John chapter 15, beginning at verse 1 and going to verse 8. I am the true vine, and my Father is the vine grower. He removes every branch in me that bears no fruit. Every branch that bears fruit, he prunes to make it bear more fruit. You have already been cleansed by the word that I have spoken to you. Abide in me as I abide in you. Just as the branch cannot bear fruit by itself unless it abides in the vine, neither can you unless you abide in me. I am the vine. You are the branches. Those who abide in me and I in them bear much fruit, because apart from me, you can do nothing. Whoever does not abide in me is thrown away like a branch and withers. Such branches are gathered, thrown into the fire, and burned. If you abide in me and my words abide in you, ask for whatever you wish and it will be done for you. My Father is glorified by this, that you bear much fruit and become my disciples. And this is the word of God for us, the people of God. Thanks be to God. And so that very first verse of John chapter 15 establishes this very simple but truthful foundation for us that Jesus is the true vine. You see, Jesus understood that Israel as a nation was not living as God had intended for them to live. Israel was to live as an example for God before the other nations. Right? God had chosen them, set them apart, that they might live lives differently than those around them. Right? Israel was to be the branches that were living out of this life in God and living this life from God. And God wanted the other nations living around Israel at that time to see how they were living their lives, and then to turn and follow him. I think the same goes for us still today, right? We are to live our lives as active witnesses to the world, to what it is that God is doing not only in us personally, but what God is doing through us, right? As we work out our way from this place out into our world, right? It's a part of what it means to be disciples of Jesus Christ. How we live our lives, how we act, the things we say, how we love, how we serve, everything we do should point back to God, right? To give God glory. And unfortunately, in Israel's day, they were allowing themselves to get a little bit distracted and to shift their focus and their attention off of God. They found other gods of the other nations that they wanted to worship instead of the one true God. And if you've ever read through the book of Judges, you will find repeated over and over and over again that it said that Israel was doing what was right in their own eyes. Not living like the people of God, but living how they wanted to live. And a slight shift off of center for Israel and even for us today, I think, is a slow and dangerous drift away from God, right? As we choose to do our own thing, to go our own way, to live life how we want to live, to glorify ourselves, right? That center that we've had slowly and slowly and slowly begins to shift off center, and to the point that perhaps we don't even recognize who we are living for anymore. And so an active and living faith requires us to stay connected to the true vine, right? I think about those spiritual practices that we can engage in, prayer, meditation on God's word, silence, solitude, Sabbath. All of these things aren't meant to be just simple tasks for us to do, but it's things that we can live into that help us grow and deepen our relationship with God. And so perhaps you notice there's a plant here today. This tiny little rose bush. I'd thought about trying to put together some posts and trellises and run some grapevines and things through, but to be honest with you, I just didn't have the time this week. So instead, I ran over to the Home Depot, and thankfully this was 20% off. For $13.59, I was able to get this beautiful rose bush. But if we think about that rose bush, and I'm going to come back to it several times throughout the course of this message today. If you think about that rose bush, and I'm sure as you look at it, perhaps those sitting in the way back, maybe it's a little bit hard to see, but most of us can probably see what's left of the flowers that have already bloomed on that rose bush. But you'll notice there are some buds that are on this rose bush, right? Ones that are beginning to kind of crack through, and you can start to see a little bit of that yellow or white color in the flowers. If I was to bring my pruning shears in right now and to clip one of those branches off that has a bud that's beginning to sprout, and to think that all I have to do is just plant it in the ground and it's somehow just going to create a brand new rose bush, I think I would be wrong. That vine, or that branch not connected to this plant, is going to die. That's where it receives its strength. That's where it receives its nutrients, its life, right? It's meant to be connected to the body of this rose bush, just like you and I are meant to be connected to the true vine. And as we find ourselves detaching from God, why would we expect that somehow we're going to have this wonderful, beautiful, vibrant life? So staying connected to the vine, right? It's a part of what we do. It's a part of who we are as disciples and followers of Jesus. And then Jesus goes on in verses 2 through 3 where he talks about how every branch that bears no fruit he removes, but the branches that do bear fruit he prunes to make them more fruitful. And so these verses remind us that pruning is essential, right? Everybody loves a good pruning in their life, right? That's what I figured. Most of us probably don't like a good pruning in our life, but God is patient with us, right? God is patient with us as he prunes away those things in our life that bear no fruit. Right? And God's pruning in our life is meant to take things away. That Greek word means just that, right? To lift up or to take away. And God takes away those things that are not beneficial for us, right? Those things that would perhaps hinder us in our relationship with God, things that would hinder us in terms of what it means for us to be disciples and followers of Jesus Christ. Pruning is meant for our health, as painful as it can be. Again, I believe this is part of what it means to be a disciple and follower of Jesus Christ. Right? Not only do we stay connected to the true vine, we need to realize that there are times and moments in our life that God is going to patiently prune away those things that are of no value for us. But the scripture tells us that God also prunes things that bear fruit in our life. And he prunes them to make them even more fruitful. Now, one of the things that's interesting about this text, as you look at the original language and you start to get down into the weeds a little bit in the Greek, there's a verb tense that's used here. And that's important because this verb tense reminds us that this pruning aspect is something that is ongoing, It's not just a one-time thing. God prunes this out and we're good to go. Thanks be to God. I don't have to worry about that again. No, this pruning is something that God does over and over and over in our lives. Again, to prune away the things that are of no value, but to prune also the things that help us be more fruitful. Right? And so an active and living faith also requires regular pruning. Now let me go back to the rose bush here for just a minute. If you've ever done any gardening of any type, rose bushes in particular, and Kay and I in our very first home had a whole bunch of rose bushes that we planted around this little patio area in the back of our home. And I had an opportunity to begin to learn what it means to take care of rose bushes. I had never really looked into it before and tried to figure out, what do I need to do? You just plant them in the ground and let them go, right? No, not at all. So rose bushes, like many plants, have disease, right? Things can come in and harm the plant. For rose bushes in particular, it's called black spot, if you've ever done any research and work around roses. And perhaps there's some chemicals, sprays, liquids, things you can put on, powders that might help the black spot on a rose bush. But at some point, that black spot can take over if it's not properly maintained and really start to affect the overall health and life of the plant. And so in order to keep the plant healthy, to keep it vibrant, to stop it from dying, those things are going to need to get pruned away. And there have been many a time with rose bushes where I've had to feel like I pruned half the thing away just to get rid of black spot. But I also researched and found out that in order to have beautiful flowers on a rose bush, it required you to prune them in just the right place. Just the right place. Because if you did that, then the plant would produce even more blooms. And so it's the same in our lives. Right? God wants to prune out those things that could cause us harm, that are not beneficial for us. And those things can be painful. But God also is trying to find ways to prune us that we can be even more fruitful. Right? And again, God is patient in doing that. And so we look at these next few verses, verses 4 through 7, and they're used here by Jesus to remind us of the importance of remaining in him. I won't go through and read those verses again, but that word abide kept coming up again and again and again throughout those verses. And in some translations, it's the word abide. In other translations, it's the word remain. But that word in the Greek also means to live or to dwell. That as we live in Christ, as we dwell in Christ, Christ lives and dwells within us. And again, this is a verb. And y'all remember what verbs are, right? They're action words, right? So this isn't something, this living, this dwelling, this abiding, this remaining. It isn't something that we do just kind of passively sitting by and hoping that somehow this is all going to work out. It's meant to be done actively, that we actively live and dwell and abide in Christ. And just like the pruning, it is also something that is ongoing. So it's a day in, day out kind of activity. Right, something that we have to live into every moment of our lives. It's not just something that we do occasionally or we can do once and we can say, well, I've lived in Christ, I'm good. I don't need to do that again. Right, again, this is part of what I think it means for us to be disciples of Jesus, that we actively seek out ways to dwell and to live in Christ, knowing that Christ has said he will live and dwell within us. And as we remain, as we abide, Jesus reminds us in verse 5 that those who abide in me and I in them bear much fruit. But he goes on, because apart from me, you can do nothing. But apart from Christ, we can do nothing. But remaining in Christ, we will produce much fruit. I don't know if you've all have ever heard of Leslie Newbigin. Perhaps you've read some of his work, British author, theologian. And I found this quote from him about being fruit bearers and what it means for us to abide and remain and produce fruit in Christ. And he had this to say, and it's one of those quotes that I'm gonna read one part to you twice, because I could probably read it about eight times, and it's still, I'm like, okay, what is he really saying here? But Leslie commented on this about being fruit bearers. The fruit is not an artifact of the disciples. It is the fruit of the vine. It is the life of Jesus himself reproduced in the lives of the disciples in the midst of the life of the world. That's the part I wanted to read twice, right? It is the life of Jesus himself reproduced in the lives of the disciples in the midst of the life of the world. And then he goes on to say, the presence of fruit is the visible evidence of the fact that the branch is a part of the vine. And so it's not what we do, right? But what Christ does in and through us as we bear fruit for Christ. Sure, we do things for Christ, right? We actively do things for Christ. We produce fruit in our lives. But it's what Christ is doing in us that allows us and helps us to be fruitful followers of Jesus. And notice that in verse 5, it says, if we abide in Christ, we will bear much fruit, right? Not just some fruit, maybe a little bit of fruit over here, a little bit of fruit over there. But if we remain and abide and live and dwell in Jesus day in and day out, Jesus promises us that we are going to bear much fruit, abundant fruit, great fruit. Of course, that word fruit is figurative language. I don't think any of us really can produce fruit, right? But it does mean, that word does mean that there is some kind of result, right? There's some kind of outcome or deed that we see in the lives of disciples. Y'all know Galatians 5:22, right? Everybody remembers that verse? I got to read it to you out of the NRSV because they throw one word in there. It wasn't what I was what I remembered growing up as a kid, memorizing the NIV. But it's love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness in the NIV, but generosity in the NRSV, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control, right? The fruit of the Spirit. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, generosity, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control, right? There's the fruit of the Spirit that we can live out in our lives. Right? And it's this fruit that we produce, the outcome of who we are as disciples and followers of Jesus, that comes from the Holy Spirit, right? It's living in lockstep with the Holy Spirit as the Holy Spirit guides us and provides guidance for us in terms of what that means for us to live out that fruit in our lives. Right, we're called to live out the good news of the gospel. And others will see the good news of the gospel by how we live. Right, again, this is a part of what it means for us to be disciples and followers of Jesus. But I also think that part of bearing fruit, it's walking alongside others. Right, that we're called to disciple one another. Disciple co-workers or friends or neighbors, children in our home, other family members, right? It's helping others grow in their discipleship and understand what it means to be a disciple and follower of Jesus Christ, how they live and remain and abide and dwell in Christ, and then what it looks like for them to live out that fruit of the Spirit in their lives each and every day. And so why would we do all of this, right? What purpose is there for us to want to remain or to abide in Christ? Why would we want to actively bear fruit for Christ? Jesus reminds us this in verse 8. My Father is glorified by this, that you bear much fruit and become my disciples. Right? God is glorified in how we bear fruit for the kingdom. God is glorified by how we live out our lives as disciples and followers of Jesus Christ, not just on Sunday mornings between the hours of 8:30 and 9:30, or 9:45 to 10:45 if you go to Sunday school. Right? Jesus wants us to live out what this means as being a disciple in every aspect of our life, right? How we treat our children, how we treat our coworkers, our neighbors, our spouses, and all for God's glory. Right? Not that we would live to glorify ourselves, but that we would live to glorify God. Jesus says in Matthew chapter 5, verse 16, in the same way, let your light shine before others, that they may see your good deeds and glorify your Father in heaven. Right? And so as we actively live our lives for Christ, we do so in word and deed. I mentioned that this past week. But it's also in how we live and how we abide in Christ each and every day, right? How we invest in that relationship with Christ. That we would actively spend time remaining in Christ each and every day. My prayer is that you have a time each day that you do that, whenever that might be. Maybe that's first thing in the morning for you or right before you go to bed. But that you'd find that time every day to spend time investing in that relationship with Jesus Christ. Because as we bear fruit, right, as we bear fruit, we show others, we show the world that we are followers and disciples of Jesus. And actively having a living faith means that we bear fruit. Right? That's a part of what it means to be disciples. So I'll come back to this rose bush again just very briefly. This rose bush doesn't produce fruit in the sense that we'd be thinking of fruit, right? It's not a fruit tree. It's got grapes on it. There's no nectarines or oranges or whatever piece of fruit you like. But it does produce flowers, right? I guess that, in a sense, is kind of its fruit. And as we think about a rose bush, it was created for one purpose, right? And that was to show its beauty by the flowers that are on it. And I believe that you and I were also created for a purpose. Right, to live our lives as disciples and followers of Jesus Christ and to glorify God in doing so. Right, we were created to bear fruit. To bear fruit that brings God glory. So I'd leave you with this thought. This question is, how and what does it look like for you to remain or abide in Christ? Right, how can you actively live into the relationship you have with Christ each and every day? Let's pray. Father God, thank you. Thank you for your Son, Jesus Christ. Thank you for the life that he lived and that he gave so that we might have life. And Father, thank you for this reminder today from John chapter 15 of our need to remain and abide in you. Father, I pray that you would help each and every person here today, those that are watching online or even those that will watch this later in this week, Lord, that they would be reminded of our need to actively remain in you, that we would seek out ways to intentionally invest in our relationship with you. And that as we do, Lord, you'd provide ways for us to bear fruit for you and to live lives that glorify you. So, Lord, empower us this day and every day by your Holy Spirit. Give us wisdom and guidance and discernment in terms of how we need to actively live as your disciples in this world. And we pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. And as we prepare to close, if you would find your hymnal and turn to number 529 as you stand in heart, mind, or spirit. And sing with me, How Firm a Foundation.
faith in his excellent word. What more can he say than to you he has said, to you for refuge to Jesus have fled. Fear not, I am with thee, oh, be not dismayed, for I am thy God, and will still give thee aid. I'll strengthen and help thee, and cause thee to stand upheld by my righteous omnipotent hand. When through the deep waters I call thee to go, the rivers of woe shall not thee overflow. For I will be with thee, thy troubles to bless, and sanctify to thee thy deepest distress. When through fiery trials thy pathway shall lie, my grace all sufficient shall be thy supply. The flame shall not hurt thee, I only design thy dross to consume and thy gold to refine. The soul that on Jesus still leans for repose, I will not desert to its foes. That soul, though all hell should endeavor to shake, I'll never, no, never, no, never forsake.
Well, just a quick reminder before we go this morning, if you are new here to us this morning, or perhaps you have been thinking about membership here at Midway United Methodist Church, Amanda and I would love an opportunity to be able to chat with you, so please come and find us here after this closing benediction. So you go with this benediction this morning. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord turn his face towards you and give you peace. Go in peace. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen and amen.